Welcome to MCN and a little slice of heaven, because today we've got the class of the 2017 Super Naked bikes, as you can see behind me, and we're on one of Europe's best roads. We're here in Germany, just outside Baden-Baden, and we're on the very famous B500, which is a stupidly twisty road that just goes on forever and ever and ever, and it's got a great mixture of really tight corners, flat out sweepers, and it's perfect really to get the best out of these Super Nakeds. Not to mention we had to ride a day to get here as well, so you get to test, as well as the performance of these bikes, how practical they are too. Super Nakeds have really come of age now. They've come a long way since their Street Fighter roots, where back in the old days you'd get a super bike, take the fairing off, put straight bars on, and there is your Super Naked. Now these are the last word in refinement. So between all these bikes, you've got electronic suspension, you've got auto blippers, quick shifters, traction control, wheelie control, engine braking control, you've got heated grips, you've got cruise control. These bikes absolutely do everything when you're just feeling lazy, or if you really want to ride fast on the roads like this or on the track. Aprilia Tuono 1100 V4 factory has got 175 bhp and weighs 186.5 kilos. Now MCN's 2011 to 2016 Super Naked champ gets a host of mods for 2017, including a Euro 4 spec motor, a 2.5 kilo heavier exhaust, a TFT Bluetooth enabled colour dash, new switch gear, lighter 43mm Ohlins forks and tweaked rear shock, bigger 330mm discs and Brembo master cylinder, more refined electronics including a new pitch and yaw sensor, an up and down blipper, pit lane limiter and cruise control. BMW's S1000R Sport has 163 bhp and weighs 200 kilos, and it benefits from a raft of changes for 2017, including a new lighter S1000RR style frame, which accounts for a big chunk of the machine's 2 kilo weight loss, and a Euro-friendly 4 motor with an extra 5 bhp. It also has Bosch IMU electronics, cornering ABS, and lean angle sensitive traction control. Standard equipment now includes an auto blipper and a quick shifter, and a titanium Akrapovic silencer. KTM 1290 Super Ducar has 177 bhp and weighs 195 kilos. It also is new for 2017, is Euro 4 compliant, and has an extra 4 bhp, tweaked WP suspension, a roomier riding position, full colour TFT dash, and the option for a track riding mode with less intrusive electronic settings. More refined rider aids include spin control, while keyless ignition, a tyre pressure monitor and cruise control come as standard. This test bike is fitted with a track pack and performance pack, which costs extra. Yamaha MT-10 SP makes 158 bhp and weighs 210 kilos. Yamaha took the world by storm last year by producing a Japanese Super Naked to rival the best Europe has to offer. Based on the current R1, the MT-10 finished runner-up in our 2016 Super Nakeds group test, just behind the Aprilia Tuono. New for 2017, this SP model costs an extra £2,600 and a semi-active Ohlins suspension, a TFT colour display, quick shifter, cruise control, and an R1M style paint job. Welcome to the B500! why do we go to B500? Because these bikes, these super nakeds, they're super bikes, they're extreme bikes, aren't they? And I think you really need to do distance to stretch their legs. So the good thing about going to the B500 is that we had to travel from Peterborough to Dover to get the Channel Tunnel and then do a fair old schlep through France down towards Metz, Strasbourg, and then we popped into Germany. And then the B500 is near Baden-Baden, which isn't too far away from the German border. Yeah. And the B500 is one of Europe's most extreme roads. It's like the Nürburgring has escaped and has made its way into into the wild.
I'll agree with that, yeah. So, I mean, it was a long way. There's no denying that.
1,300 miles we did.
There and back.
Yes.
Yeah, I thought I was a bit numb at the end.
Yeah.
But then not that bad because, I mean, let's talk about the practical stuff first.
The boring stuff.
Yeah, because we did a lot of miles on the motorway and, you know, they're naked bikes, there's no screens and all that. So which was the comfiest?
Do you know what? No one bike had the full set of comfort. So depending on, we're all different size riders, aren't we? So some of us found bikes more comfortable than others.
Yeah.
The Yamaha and the KTM had by far the most leg room.
Yes.
The Yamaha had the most wind protection.
Yep.
The BMW had the best heated grips. The others had none.
Yeah. I wondered why you were on that.
Exactly. Much. Yeah. But it was bit cramped. None of them are particularly uncomfortable, which is the good thing about super nakeds. So they got super bike performance, but you don't have to pay for that with discomfort. And the really mad thing about all these bikes, have all got cruise control, haven't they?
Yeah.
Who would have thought a set of performance bikes would all have cruise control? So we were all going down the motorway, just adjusting ourselves, just you know, 1 mile an hour at a time. Nice and easy.
That's
they're nice places to be. They've got nice flat bars. You don't get sore wrists or sore back.
Yeah.
They are really comfortable, really.
Yeah. Super bike with flat bars.
Yeah.
Quite simply. Okay, so we've talked about the comfiest and the best wind protection. What about toys? You mentioned that the BMW's got the heated grips.
Yeah.
What about switchgear?
Do you know with the BMW, no surprise, wins the clearest clocks, the best thought out switchgear. All the other bikes got colour dashes now, haven't they?
Yeah, they've got them TFT.
And the Aprilia and the KTMs are pretty confusing, and the switchgear on the Yamaha on the Aprilia just looks like
a bit cluttered.
Looks like it's been fired out of a 12-bore shotgun. It's really hard to use, but the BMW is really easy. But they've all got loads of toys, so they've all got quick shifters and auto blippers.
Yep.
Apart from the Yamaha, hasn't got an auto blipper, which is kind of conspicuous by its absence.
Yep.
We've all got traction control. We've all got wheelie control. But why you'd have wheelie control on the super naked is. But luckily, you can turn them all off. They've all got riding modes. They've basically got every electronic bell and whistle you could possibly think of.
So when we were on the B500 then, away from the motorway, what was the most exciting for you?
Well, all of them are exciting. You ride any one of these bikes in isolation and you'll go home a gibbering mess. So they all tick the boxes when it comes to giving you incredible amounts of excitement. The KTM's exciting in its own way. It feels like a giant supermoto, doesn't it? The BMW with its electronic suspension and incredible stability feels like the race bike it's based on. You've got the MT10, which has kind of got the cross-plane crank engine that kind of thinks it's a cross between a V4 and a V-twin and an inline four and an electric motor. It's got all these
lovely
characters, and the noise of it is incredible. And then you've got the Aprilia, which the Aprilia's up there when it comes to fun. The others are fighting for second place, really.
Yeah.
The Aprilia's just got the engine, first and foremost. It's a characterful engine. It's 1100, so it's got more torque and grunt than the RSV4. It's not quite as tuned, so it's not as extreme or peaky as the superbike. But the suspension and the tyres on it, just incredible. The amount of grip you've got and the speed you can rush into corners with complete safety and confidence, like you're on slicks on the track.
Yeah.
It's just you can leave the other bikes behind after three or four corners with ease. And because of that, it feels like you're cheating, which because of that gives you a buzz and that's much more fun, isn't it?
It was pretty easy to ride. It was, like you say, when you came into the corners, it you only had to look and it was already there.
So much grip. You can just lean and lean and lean that bike. It had the best tyres on the test. Yeah. The second best tyres on the test were they had supercourses. The KTM had Sport Tex, which were really good tyres. But disappointingly, the Yamaha and the BMW have kind of quite old generation Bridgestones, which don't really match up to the performance of the bike. So that's a bit disappointing. I think if we'd have put control tyres on all the bikes, you would have levelled them all up.
Yeah.
But there's an argument against control tyres because they're sold with these tyres, so we're going to test them like this.
Agreed,
but,
yeah.
Because there was no track element. If there's a track element to this test, it would be unfair not to put control tyres on the bike, but for the purposes of the test. But even so, the Aprilia would still be a league ahead of the others in terms of excitement, fun factor, poise, handling, stability, agility, the whole.
But on their own, we were obviously spoiled because we could ride them all back to back. But if you'd have taken any one of those,
you'd swear it's the best bike in the world.
Yeah,
exactly.
So, and we kind of talked about best handling as well, because the Aprilia came out on top with that one as well.
Yeah, I mean, that is a proper racetrack refugee, but it's not as extreme as a superbike, so it's really easy to ride. You know, the fact it's wider and roomier makes it easier. You feel more comfortable on it all the time.
It definitely felt the most sporty out of all four of them.
Yeah, exactly.
Just in the way you were sat, even the way the leg position and the way you were sort of hunched over it a little bit. The KTM, as you said, was kind of supermoto-esque. It had that pedigree from KTM with their off-road. It was kind of over the front a little bit more than the others.
Yeah.
But yeah, it definitely...
Who's doing this? Me or you?
I don't know. I don't know
what I'm joking.
But the thing is, the good thing about these super nakeds is you got more sense of speed than a superbike. If you were going the same speed as we were going through Baden-Baden, through this B500, which is all speed limit, obviously, they'd feel slow on a superbike because they feel so capable. But with a super naked, you've got the wind rush. So 90 kilometres an hour feels like 90 kilometres an hour.
Yes.
You know, so you get better sense of speed. There's no point with a superbike on the road, really, you know, because you just don't get that thrill.
I agree. I was always a superbike man, but I remember riding the Super Duke GT last year, and I was instantly transformed to wanting more naked style bikes because they're easier to manage. Just the character of them is a lot different, and they are a lot more fun.
Mm.
So, yeah. Do they really have superbike performance?
Yes. Yeah. So
my arms are still aching. Yeah. Now, I think.
Yeah. They've all got 160, 170 horsepower. I mean, that was what superbikes made really before the S1000RR came along. GSXRs, R1s, ZX10s, and that was more than enough for everyone, wasn't it? So not only has it got superbike performance, got superbike chassis, superbike suspension, superbike brakes. They are superbikes that are comfortable.
Go on then, which is the best?
Well, it's Aprilia's up there in every respect. It's expensive. I think it's the most expensive bike on the test, but it's well worth it. If you're going to take the plunge with these super nakeds, and they are all very expensive, then the Aprilia is best. You know, there are this kind of the second tier of super nakeds, if you like, with the street speed triples, the Monster R's, then you've got the next rung down with the Z1000 GSXS's. They're all as much fun, but these are the extreme, the most expensive.
The elite.
The elite. Good word. Good word. The elite. So the Aprilia is by far the best, which leaves the others really squabbling for second place. And they are really close. And like we said, ridden in isolation, they're all fantastic.
Yeah. They all have pros and cons against
each other. But when you look at it overall, you'd have to say that the MT10 SP was runner-up because it was so close to the Toyota, really, in terms of its character and its engine. And really what Yamaha have done by making this bike, that's the first ever Japanese super naked. It's also the roomiest, the best wind protection. It's got cruise control, it's got everything as well. Third place we had down is the BMW because of its refinement, because of its stability, its performance. Didn't quite match up to the top two with regards to fun factor because an inline four engine hasn't got the character of these V-twins, V-fours, cross-plane cranks. And then bringing up the rear was the KTM. I mean, the KTM wasn't as good on fast sweeping corners. It was more stop-start. The engine is just a masterpiece of grunt, but it's not that refined. It's a little bit agricultural compared to the others because it's a twin, and it would be.
Big twin at that.
Yeah, but they're all those sort of bottom three or runner-ups are all so close.
Yeah,
but the Aprilia is something else.
Yeah, and what about price then? Because actually the KTM's quite expensive, isn't it?
Yeah, with all of these bikes, it's hard to actually put your finger on how much they are, because the basic bikes are quite cheap.
Yeah.
But as we've tested them with all the different bits and bobs on them, so you've got the performance pack that was on the KTM, which gives you this track mode and quick shifters. You've got the BMW had lightweight wheels, you know,
forged
alley wheels, which make a big difference to the ride quality and the agility of it. So yeah, the Aprilia is the most expensive, but it's worth it.
Final thoughts?
I want the Aprilia to take home. When we had to give that bike back, that broke my heart. And you always think, oh, I'm never going to ride it again, you know, never get the chance.
I'm not choosy, I'll have any of them.
Yeah, I'll have any of them, but that Aprilia is something else.